You know, it just seemed whatever issue you picked up at Adams State, whether it's shared governance or whether it was athletics or whether it had to do with, you know, faculty salaries or summer salaries or anything of that nature, it always seemed as if behind every administrative door there was a secret, and that if those secrets got out, everything was going to collapse. So there seemed to be that kind of fear.
Thank you for joining us on another edition of the Watching Adams podcast. I'm Danny Ladoni. Today's guest is Dr. Ben Waddell. He's a sociologist who taught at Adams State between 2011 and 2016. Ben really wanted to focus in on a few areas here that include the disappearance of public higher education and the ramification it has, particularly for smaller schools in rural areas like Adams State, and really the kind of downstream effects of what it looks like when funding for public higher ed disappears in terms of campus politics, finance, the prioritization or perhaps misprioritization of athletics on campus, and the culture of athletics that had a corrosive effect on the academic experiences of students on campus, and what Ben observes as the secrets behind ASU's administrative doors. As Ben investigated some of the problems on the ASU campus, he discovered that there were secrets he was told not to get too deep into because it would create disruption or the results would disturb people on campus. Ben also discusses his perspective and role in the banning of myself from campus in 2015 by Beverly McClure and his efforts to reason with the then president to try and find an amicable solution prior to any lawsuit, which ended up being the result. Ben talks about why he decided to leave Adams State amidst this turmoil, including being labeled as a sexist male professor by the first female president of the university, his time teaching abroad in Nicaragua, and some observations about what we as Americans can learn from the inequalities in Latin America and its ramifications for the United States, including public higher education. All that and more on this edition of the Watching Adams podcast.
Yeah, so my name is Ben Waddell. I'm an associate professor of sociology here at Fort Lewis College in Durango. Spent the last 2 years working for the School of International Training in Managua, Nicaragua. And prior to that, I was working at Adams State University in the San Luis Valley, where I was there from 2011 to 2016. And I held the position of assistant professor of sociology and associate professor of sociology. And before that, I'd been at the University of New Mexico, which is where I did my graduate work. And I taught Spanish as a second language there and sociology once I moved into the PhD program.
So what initially attracted you to Adams State? At that time, it was Adams State College?
Yeah, it was Adams State College at the time. It was 2010. It was early in the fall. I was in graduate school still working on passing comps for my PhD program. So I'd taken all my coursework, and I was starting to think about whether or not I wanted to go down the kind of the research track or the teaching track, as a lot of people refer to it when you're in graduate school. And the research track is more thinking about, you know, publishing and getting into the right journals and trying to land a job at a R1 institution, in which you would teach very little and spend most of your time doing research. And the teaching track is kind of the opposite, which is, of course, the track I ended up taking, in which you spend a lot more time working with undergraduate students, usually teaching 3 to 4 classes per semester, sometimes more. And you generally focus on the teaching end of things while doing some writing as well. I was, you know, thinking about these things in 2010, thought a lot about my own career trajectory as a first-generation student and someone who had just really relied a lot on mentors at the college level, professors and other staff members of the University of Colorado Boulder and here at Fort Lewis, really helped me kind of see the importance in higher education as well as think about what I wanted to do with my life. And so when it came down to it, I thought, you know, that's the track that I want to put myself on. I want to get into teaching so that I can be a mentor for students that are looking for that type of help on a college campus. And so I looked at different jobs in the Southwest, and there was an opening at Adams State, and it ended up, you know, working out that I got hired at Adams State, and I started in January 2011.
So what were some of your initial impressions of the campus? What were some of your expectations going in, and what were those first few years of teaching at Adams like for you?
Yeah, I guess, I mean, I really didn't have too many expectations expectations. I mean, I was somewhat naive about the differences or the nuances of, you know, college campuses. I'd gone to state schools. My experience had been very good as an undergraduate, but I wasn't involved in campus politics or anything of that nature. And so I wasn't very in tune with some of the things that ended up, you know, kind of really impacting Adams State's campus over the next 7 years in terms of, you know, financial shortcomings and things of that nature. So my initial impression was, you know, there was a lot of really great students that really needed good, meaningful professors in the classroom, people willing to go the extra mile and really willing to put in the extra hours to help students in some cases catch up and in some cases just, you know, really get a sense of what they wanted to do with their professional careers. And so from day one, started working very closely with students, mentoring students. I felt like I had, you know, most of the infrastructure and the support that I needed to do the work I was doing. There's a lot of capital construction going on campus. There's new buildings going up. Enrollment at that time was going up. I mean, it felt like a really, like I'd kind of landed the job I'd be with for the rest of my career.
So you were there from 2011 to 2016?
That's correct, in the fall, yeah. I started a new position in the spring of 2017.
So you really were there for kind of the rise and the peak of Adams State's enrollment, at least as we see it today in 2018. You saw dramatic changes across campus. You saw President Saval, who was there for a significant amount of time in a faculty and administrative position and then became president in about 2006. And so he was there until 2015, at which point Beverly McClure became the president. And so you saw some of these things happening. And it sounds like you came in pretty fresh-faced and just ready to get in the classroom, engage and interact with students. What were some of the things that were working really well for you while you were at Adams State? And did that start to change at all?
I think what worked really well for me from the beginning and throughout the time that I spent at Adams State is I had some really strong colleagues. I remember very distinctly, you know, having a mentor set up for me in my first semester at Adams State, and that individual, you know, just really had been teaching for a few decades at that time. That individual just really helped me gauge how to approach students, how to work with students, how to think about in-class activities to a more engaging kind of active classroom. And so, you know, a lot of the work that was being done at Adams that I was involved with, I thought it was really positive. You know, some of the work that I think I cared most about was the work that I was doing with Title V and some of the equity retreats that I was a part of. I think that work was really powerful and it had a deep lasting impact on myself and many of my colleagues. I think I entered Adams State thinking about education as what takes place in the classroom. I think I left with a deeper understanding of education being something that really extends beyond the classroom, right? It's mentoring, it's meeting students where they need to be met. It's trying to understand where historic factors like colonialism intersect with students' experience on campus. And those were some of the things that I really became in tune with at Adams State. I think I became a much better teacher and professor while I was at Adams State.
So during that time, did you more or less get the sense that you wanted to stay at Adams State and that you were thinking to yourself, this is where I'd actually like to really build and continue my career?
Yeah, I mean, I would say by 2013, 2014, I was, you know, really settling into life in Alamosa at Adams State. I mean, my family and I were tied into the community and still are. I mean, we go over to Alamosa frequently now that we're back in the States. And so I think there was always a part of us that was thinking about, well, you know, we're young, maybe there's other opportunities. And so, of course, you know, like many people, I was looking at other opportunities. But there was a part of us that just really, really enjoyed the community and, you know, music on Sunday nights in the summer. And, you know, I think about the music department on campus and some of the events they put on, as well as the theater department. I mean, there was a pretty, even though it's a small environment and it was a small community, there's a very vibrant community that surrounded Adams State. And that was really strong, especially initially during my experience there. And so, you know, there was this strong part of us that thought, you know, this might be where we stay.
So Adams State was doing really well for you. It sounds like you were doing really well for Adams State. What started to happen? What were some of the initial hurdles that you realized were perhaps more systemic or entrenched than you might have initially thought? we all encounter challenges in the workplace, but they don't always compel us to look elsewhere for work. What was that process like for you?
I think I started, like I said, I wasn't terribly involved with campus politics in undergrad, and I wasn't either in graduate school, but I wasn't oblivious to what was going on either. You know, I remember being at CU Boulder and watching tuition go up about $500 per year every year and thinking something's off, something's amiss. The rate of inflation of tuition while I was in college was really high, was much higher than, you know, the rate at which wages were increasing, for example. And, you know, now as a professor that looks at these types of things and thinks about these type of things, I look back at the trends and you see that tuition in the last 40 years has just skyrocketed in terms of its cost to students compared to what it was in the 60s or 70s. And so, you know, I was aware of these things tangentially. And, you know, by the time I was in graduate school, I was obviously noticing trends. You know, you would, at first, you're super excited to have the opportunity to teach. And then you realize that, you know, the three or four classes you were teaching at a massive discount were really classes that allowed, you know, the few professors who had tenure at the large institution to have large salaries. And so you start seeing these inequities. You know, there was, I would say at UNM, the national average seems around 60-70% of classes are taught by adjuncts. And I would say at UNM it was probably somewhat similar, somewhere in there, between adjuncts and graduate students. And so those were trends that I was aware of. I wasn't involved with efforts to think about changing them necessarily. But when I got to Adams, I started to notice, you know, similar things that tied into those trends. The budget crunch across the nation. Most of the listeners that are, you know, tuned into Watching Adams are probably pretty aware of these numbers, but over the last 40 years, the cost of tuition has gone up. But the reason that has happened is largely because state and federal government transfers have been reduced. And so there's been this reduction of state support. I think Adams State, you know, I remember being in some meetings and hearing numbers like as late as around 2000 had 65% of its support coming from the state and federal government. And by the time 2013, 2014 came around, I think that was down to the numbers were closer to 65% were coming from tuition. So much more than half was coming from tuition. I'm sure that's increased since then. I think it has at most universities. I remember when I was at CU Boulder as an undergraduate, I graduated in 2005, but every single year there was conversation of if CU Boulder, the flagship university of the state of Colorado, there was conversations about whether or not I'd go private because it was under 10% state funding and federal funding. So that's part of this conversation, and it's a part that I've always thought is kind of central to understanding what happened at Adams State. In the United States, we don't have public education. It doesn't exist anymore. We have different degrees of private education that's subsidized by the state. And so, you know, whether your university receives 15% or 20% of funding from the state, the fact is that the majority of education in the United States today is paid for by tuition. And that's just distinct and vastly different than what education looked like in 1960 or 1970. And so we've had this really generational shift in the way in which we fund education. And I think that really has changed the way professors, students, and staff think about education, both in terms of how faculty and staff deliver it, as well as how students receive it. And so when I got to Adams State, I wasn't completely in tune with these things, but I quickly started realizing that these larger national trends were affecting Adams. And, you know, I used to bring some of this into my intro to sociology class. We'd talk about education and the sociology education for a week. You know, we'd look at the state budget, and I remember in 1990, about the time Tabor Act was passed, you'd have about 20% of the state budget going to higher education. And by 2013, 2014, that was about down to 8%. So,
can you just quickly summarize for those of us listening, especially outside Colorado, what Tabor is, the Tabor Act, T-A-B-O-R?
Yeah, and I don't want to get too far into the details because I haven't read up on it recently, but, you know, it's something that has been in the background of, you know, conversations in education across the state of Colorado as long as I can remember, and I grew up in Colorado. But the Tabor Act was passed in, you know, kind of the heydays of the neoliberal years, 1990, 91, somewhere in there. But it basically restricts the amount of the budget that can go to education, and it makes it very difficult to increase the amount of the state budget that goes to education. It makes it even more difficult to actually get taxpayers to agree to increasing the amount of money going to education. And so what it essentially has done over the last 30 years is put an extreme crunch on institutions of education, both K through 12 and higher education. And it's made it more and more difficult for universities and education facilities across the state to keep up with the rest of the nation. In fact, if you compare Colorado to the rest of the nation in terms of its funding from the state, usually around 48th, 47th, 29th out of 50 states. So it's really, really affected the way in which the state can fund education. It's basically institutionalized austerity.
So I'm going to ask the next question in two parts. And the first part would be the answer you just gave a minute ago about the challenges you faced at Adams State sounds like it would come from someone in the finance department. I'm curious to know how those kinds of things impacted you as a faculty member. Like, why should you care what the state's allocation of budget to higher ed is if you walk into a classroom and there's a group of eager students to learn every day? Why does that matter to you?
Yeah, that's a really great question. I mean, in part, I got close to the numbers because I was on different committees that were charged with kind of trying to help think about how to solve these dwindling budgets. And so, you know, I started thinking about this from, you know, 22,000 feet up. I started thinking of the macro picture and trying to understand it. And so, you know, I give that as kind of to set the stage for the next question you asked, which is, and the answer to that is, you know, I think it affects everyone a little bit differently. But I think, you know, personally, the way in which I started seeing it affects me is, you know, you're excited coming out of graduate school just to get a job. It's a super difficult job to get. A tenure track job in today's world of higher education is extremely hard to come by because the number of tenure track positions have been reduced a great deal over the last 30 years. And so you're extremely excited to get that position. What you don't realize is that the wages that that position pays haven't kept up with, you know, the cost of goods and services. So when I started back in 2011, the starting wages for my position was 41,000, I think. And so 41K with benefits. And now I think they're starting individuals at 45, 46. But I remember being on hiring committees 6 years after I was hired and having to really push for a starting wage above 42. And so, and that's not unique to Adams State, but what that means on an everyday level is that, you know, in my case, my family grew, we started having kids, we started, you know, looking at thinking of buying a house, those types of things, or a car. Those type of things became increasingly difficult on just that basic salary. And so
you thought you could actually enter the middle class with a PhD, Ben. That's the mistake you made.
That is the mistake I made, Danny. And I guess I wasn't even, you know, I wasn't even thinking about that. I was thinking about the PhD, and I was thinking about getting in the classroom, working with students, and I just wasn't giving that much thought to the actual income. The truth of the matter is what it pushes you to do is take on more responsibilities, right? And I think that became very clear once I was on campus, and there was a pretty big push in my department across campus, I think you could say, to push online classes. I didn't understand where that push was coming from, and I started to understand after being on campus for a few years. And I didn't teach online classes initially. You know, the reason was is I wanted to focus on my classes and I wanted to do well what I was trying to do in the classroom. But once I did start teaching online classes and there was great encouragement across campus for individuals to teach those classes, I realized that it was extremely difficult to maintain the same quality that you deliver in the actual classroom in online classrooms. And it's not that you can't do it. It's that it's very difficult to do while balancing a full load in the classroom with a full load online. And so I wasn't surprised necessarily when the research and investigation started coming back from the HLC that found that their professors teaching, you know, basically overloads online and in person. Certainly there were some individuals that were clearly abusing that system in ways that break with, you know, basic ethics. But I think in general, if you look across campus, you just saw a lot of people taking on extra work because it was just necessary in order to get their wages up to a level and allow them to live a basic middle class life. They had to teach a lot of extra classes. And that, I think at the individual level, it pulls at your strings. Like, there's just not enough time in the day to fulfill everything that you commit to once you start signing up for committees and online classes and all the other stuff. And so what the budget crunch has done in the last 30 years is it's pushed a bigger and bigger load on professors' plates.
So in other words, you started at Adams State, the salary was certainly lower than the national average, but it made it challenging to kind of do the things that one would think a position like that would allow for in terms of starting a family, buying a house, things of that nature. And when it was time to look at how to raise, you know, that pay for yourself and for other faculty, the response was, well, you can teach more, and you can teach more through these online programs that we offer. And as more people did that, you and perhaps others saw that there was a cost to the quality of education you were delivering, perhaps perhaps online, but also even in person if there's only so much time in your day. You're teaching 4 classes on campus. Now you're teaching, what, an additional 2-3 classes online during that same time period?
You could find yourself in that scenario pretty quick, and I think a lot of people did. And it becomes a lot to balance. It affects personal lives as well. I mean, if you're working all day and then you come home and then you're, you know, grading papers online all night, obviously that puts a crunch on relationships, and both with kids and spouses and such. And so the ways in which this affects individuals is, you know, multiple, and it depends on the individual case. But I just don't think it's unique to Adams State. I mean, Adams State had something unique in the sense that cost of living was pretty low. So lower salaries, you know, in some ways allowed you to live a pretty good life in the San Luis Valley, despite the fact that the salaries are lower than other institutions across the country. But if you look at other institutions in larger cities, and the majority of institutions are growth of enrollment and such, or generally at institutions in larger cities due to demographics, if you look at those spaces, they're increasingly difficult to live in for individuals at a professor's pay. And so I think it's something that we see happening across the country. And it's, you know, it has to do with a declining commitment to higher education and education in general over the last 30, 40 years. I mean, there's just been a real backslide in terms of the amount of support voters are willing to push towards education, which is somewhat ironic because, you know, many of the people that make up the voting bloc, the baby boomers who vote most frequently in elections, happen to be those who most benefited from the time period in the United States in which taxation provided the most in terms of social benefits and nets, which would be, you know, 1940s, 50s, and 60s. So it is somewhat ironic that those that benefited most from that taxation and redistribution are now the ones reducing this generation's ability to access the same benefits they benefited from.
Well, they got low-cost college growing up, and now they're getting fully funded Social Security and Medicare going out, and they're closing the door behind them. So they got theirs. Ben, I want to go back to our earlier question that I was going to follow up on, which is, given how much of what you described being a national problem, the trends in higher education, why would you leave Adams State, given that what you're describing is not unique to that institution? What was it about Adams State specifically that gave you pause and had you looking more at other positions as opposed to settling in, realizing that this was just the state of higher education nationally and, you know, you were already in a tenured position in a community that you cared about? What was so significant that you decided that you wanted to look elsewhere and walk away from that?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I've been looking at different opportunities throughout the time as Adams State. I had a sense that, especially early on, that Adams State is where I was going to stay. That changed in 2015. It didn't change initially, but there were a few things about that presidential hire in 2015, which President Beverly McClure ends up being successful as a candidate and comes in as the new president of Adams State. There were a few things about the hiring process as well as the outcome of her tenure at Adams State that I think really, you know, made me consider my future at that institution. And so the first had to do with the hiring process. I mean, it was clear amongst faculty that there was another candidate, a Hispanic candidate, who, you know, a lot of experience in higher education, both as faculty and then as a leader. You know, it was pretty much, there was a strong consensus amongst faculty and staff that individual would probably be a better way to go forward. And administration, or at least some individuals with administration, pinned Adams State's solution, because it was clear that there was, you know, some financial issues on campus, that Adams State's solution was going to be needed to be in the hands of someone who understood business. And that individual within that pool of three was Beverly Clure. You know, I wasn't on the hiring committee, but I did know some representatives, and they said it was very clear. Administration pointed to who they felt had that ability to bring in business experience. And once that was on the table, it was clear that Beverly Clure was going to be the candidate they chose, which went against what the faculty had voted for. And so that gave me pause, but it was really the way in which Beverly Clure approached issues on campus and the divisive nature in which she approached those issues that made me think that maybe it was time for me to look for other opportunities.
I guess what strikes me about that answer is that, you know, over the course of any faculty member's career, they're probably going to encounter administrations, including presidents, that they like more than others. I guess I'm surprised that you saw that as much of a deal breaker as you did. Can you elaborate on why you didn't decide to just stick it out? You're already a tenured faculty member, and unless you saw some impending budget cut that was going to decimate your own department, why not just, you know, button down the hatches and ride out the storm?
I think a lot of it had to do with the HLC, and, you know, when the HLC put Adam State on probation, and, you know, the issues that it highlighted with online education were real.
So just stopping there for a second, the Higher Learning Commission put Adam State on academic probation in the spring of 2016, and they did so citing a number of non-compliance or you know, serious concerns with regard to how it was running its online coursework, which you talked about earlier. Did any of the HLC's findings and the subsequent investigation that was commissioned later by Dr. Gilmer, did any of that surprise you, or what were some of the takeaways that you had, having been someone who taught online while teaching on campus, that was cited as a concern given the number of students and the number of courses that any instructor was teaching at the time?
No, it didn't surprise me. I don't think it surprised anyone on campus. I mean, I think it was bound to happen. It was going to happen. I mean, Adams State had one of the earliest online education programs in the game. And, you know, by 97, 98, Adams State was really kind of they're at the vanguard, at the forefront of this movement of online education. And I think that provided Adams State with a unique opportunity to bring income into an institution that is rural and that doesn't necessarily have the ability to bring people into, you know, actual seats like a large institution in an urban center might. And I also think it gave Adams State an opportunity to really think about what online education meant in the late 90s and early 2000s and kind of define what that course would be. I think Adams State had the unfortunate luck of getting into online education at a time when support for education at the state and federal level was about ready to plummet. And so online education became, not overnight, but fairly quickly, one of the main revenue sources for Adams State College and then later university. And so I think that put administrators in a tough position. It put faculty and staff in a tough position because at the institutional level, it was a large part of income that really allowed the institution to meet its, you know, kind of bottom line every year. For faculty, it represented the same thing on the home front. And for many staff, it did as well, because there were staff that were also teaching online. And so I think it was, you know, a really tough position for anyone on campus to come together and say, we really need to rethink the way we're doing this, backtrack and reduce the number of classes we teach, and improve the engagement that we're providing online. And so, you know, I think there's both, you know, there's reason to cite concern for the ways in which online education was taking place on campus. I think there's also an opportunity to, you know, step back and look at what happened at Adams with online education and think about how that reflects the, you know, kind of greater state of education across the country. And so, you know, I wasn't surprised. There was an individual that worked in AITC who, when I first came to Adams State, was talking about these issues that the HLC letter, you know, 4 or 5 years later was bringing up. That individual left, but was really clear on the college's need to address these issues, and that if they didn't, it wasn't going to be pretty, and it was likely going to lead to probation or something similar. And so I wasn't surprised. I'd heard people having those conversations. I think it was, you know, simply a matter of every single year, Adams State found itself in a situation which tuition made up a bigger part of its budget, and costs continued to go up for goods and services, and online education was always the savior. And, you know, eventually there had to be a reckoning day, but I don't think anyone was surprised. I certainly wasn't.
Given that most people on campus seemed to recognize that this was an ongoing issue, that it merited concern, because when the HLC came back with these findings, they said that this is unacceptable, and not many people were surprised about those findings. Was there any internal correction that was attempted or concern that was voiced? And what happened that this wasn't a problem that was corrected internally using the mechanisms of shared governance or the way the administration listened to faculty voices to address those concerns? Why did it take someone from the outside coming in to identify a problem that everyone knew existed?
I mean, that's a really good question. I think part of it has to do with the degree to which online education was centralized prior to the HLC changes. It was centralized within a center that was outside of individual departments. Individual departments didn't have that much say over online education. And so even if there were concerns, it wasn't like it was necessarily, you couldn't just, you know, go change it. You couldn't change what your department was doing necessarily. And I mean, there were, it's interesting, but I know of positions that were filled without departments ever being consulted. So even without a department on campus approving those positions being filled, you would have positions being filled for those online classes. And so it kind of ran itself outside of department's purview. And I think that reduced the way in which individual departments could actually influence how much change took place.
I want to transition now to talk a little bit about what your view was of being a faculty member at a school that has a disproportionately high number of student athletes. I read that Adams State had somewhere between 2 and 3 times the normal number or the average number of student athletes on campus compared to other Colorado institutions, and sometimes actually much greater than that. And I always wondered what effect that had for other faculty in the classroom when athletics had such a prominent role on the campus.
Yeah, I think that's a super interesting question. And, you know, it's as we kind of transition away from talking about one thing and transitioning to this, I was thinking a bit about this over the weekend. And, you know, it just seemed whatever issue you picked up at Adams State, whether it was shared governance or whether it was athletics or whether it had to do with, you know, faculty's salaries or summer salaries or anything of that nature, it always seemed as if behind every administrative door there was a secret, and that if those secrets got out, everything was going to collapse. So there seemed to be that kind of fear. I started noting that early on, and one of the the realms that I noticed that most was with athletics. There seemed to be something about student athletes on campus that were untouchable, in a similar way that online education couldn't be questioned and couldn't be looked into. It wasn't the type of thing that you wanted to ask questions about because you'd be turned back. And I got that sense with student athletics as well. I started asking my intro classes, just out of interest, early on, about how many of them were student athletes. You know, usually in a class of 40 intro students, you'd have half. And so I thought, you know, that was a pretty strong trend to have half of a class in every intro class say they were student athletes. And so 20 out of 40.
Yeah, I think I read something between 10 to 15% of on most campuses are student athletes. They're there on an athletic scholarship and they participate in one or more of the sports that are officially sanctioned by the NCAA. But Adams State was much higher.
And I think the actual numbers are closer to 43% or something for Adams. But here's what I found even more interesting is then I would ask how many of you came initially as student athletes. And oftentimes in a class of 40, you'd be pushing 30 students that had come originally as student athletes to Adams State. And so it wasn't just the presence of student athletes who were actually concurrently competing on campus. It was also the presence of a lot of students that had come as student athletes that realized that wasn't what they, you know, what they wanted to do, or perhaps it wasn't what it panned out to be or what they'd been sold on. And I got the sense kind of early on that it was, you know, it was very much part of the recruiting process at Adams State, that student athletes were a way to fill seats. And I don't say that lightly because, you know, I participated in sports in high school and I even considered in college playing sports. But in high school, I was extremely involved in sports. And I think in many ways, sports kind of guided me towards academics as I think they should, right? I had good coaches and they were very thoughtful coaches, and they're the type of coaches that taught life lessons through sports. And I think that's where athletics is usually at its best within an academic realm. But at Adams State, I got a sense that at least in some sports, and not all, that those messages were getting lost. And I got to know some of the recruiters, and recruiters tended to come and go frequently at Adams State. But in getting to know some of the recruiters in playing intramural sports and different things at Adams, you know, it became very clear to me that they were actually given numbers or quotas. I mean, there were individuals on the lacrosse team and several other teams that said in the spring, you know, I can't hang out or I can't play tonight for an intramural game because they had a quota to meet and they hadn't met it yet. And so they would have 50 or 60 people on roster and they said, we don't really need any more, but administration's told us we need an extra 15 to 20. And so they would spend their nights, their evenings looking, calling people across the country, across the world to come to Adams State to play sports. I don't know to what degree they promised scholarships, but, you know, I think that was generally what lured students in is the promise of a package, either to be in or eventually, right? The promise that if you come and you perform well, you'll be able to, you know, get on scholarship. And I know that's nothing, it's not new. I mean, it's not unique to Adams State. When I was in high school, I remember, you know, sports recruiters not offering me scholarships, but telling me, you know, within a year or two, you'd be on scholarship. And so it's definitely the type of tactic that I think is used frequently, but it seems to have been used much more frequently at Adams State. And I think the numbers reflect that.
Your observations remind me of the first time some of these thoughts went through my head, and I had a student come up and inform me that she was on Adams State's golf team, and she handed me a slip of paper that says, this student will be missing the following days to do, you know, traveling golf tournaments. And it looked like, you know, a significant number of the classes in the next coming week she was going to be missing. And I thought to myself, well, do I have any choice but to accept that this student is going to be missing all these classes and that I can't evaluate her participation in class negatively as a result? And I was thinking to myself, well, maybe I should draft a letter to send with her to her coaches saying, this student has classes at the following times. Please excuse them from any games or tournaments you might be holding during these times. And then I also thought to myself, well, I'm teaching the student how to use Photoshop and how to do video and audio editing. It seems to me that might have more relevance to her future career path than professional golf. And so I really began to think about how inverted those priorities might be and how just assumed it was that this was kind of the institutional priorities that were laid forth and not to be questioned.
Yeah, I mean, I tend to think all this hooks back into links back into our previous conversation in terms of, you know, think about national trends and stuff. I remember in 2015, I went to a conference in Minneapolis, and at that time, they were just finishing their massive new stadium for the Vikings. And I just remember flying into Minneapolis and seeing the stadium. And if you look it up, you'll see this image of this massive stadium in the skyline. I mean, it dominates everything within the skyline. It was one of the first times that I said, you know, this is out of proportion. There's something about organized sports in the United States that's out of proportion with reality. I mean, below that large stadium in Minneapolis, there's lots of people that are homeless. There are people that are not going to good schools or can't get into schools or can't pay for schools. There's people that are moving out of Minnesota because there's not enough jobs. And yet there's enough economic interest or wealth accumulation to build a massive stadium, you know. And I think when we look at our overall society, we start to understand why a place like Adams State would be able to recruit so successfully on athletics. We have a society in which the culture of sports has been, it's no pun intended, but I mean, it's kind of on steroids in the sense that when you look at sports over the last 20 to 15 years, you see this growth of kind of a marketing scheme in which sports athletes are kind of, they become the equivalent of superheroes or the equivalent of legendary political figures. I mean, you look at these folks and they dress the way political figures would or economically successful people would, and most of them are economically successful. But there's a culture beneath that that I think permeates youth across the country and leads to this perception that if you're good at your local high school or in your middle school or at a place like Adams State, you might have a shot of becoming one of these individuals. And I saw that within my students. I mean, I would ask students in my intro classes always what they wanted to do with their lives. Like, what was it that they wanted to use this human capital that they come to Adams State to obtain for? And student athletes would surprise me every single year. And a number of them would answer, I want to play professional sports. And I mean, that ran across track and field, which at Adams State, I think people had a more viable chance of becoming professional athletes, but also through football, where, you know, basically the chance was, the probability of becoming a professional athlete was close to zero. Basketball, same thing. And you'd see it across wrestling, et cetera. You'd see this deep-seated belief that they could become a professional athlete and make money and survive doing that. And so they seem to discount the importance of their education as a result of that. And I think that, you know, you'd asked, how did this affect me as a faculty member? It affected me in the sense that the culture of sports came into the classroom and affected the engagements of other students that weren't part of sports. And so I think it's one thing if you have 15 to 20% of your student body as student athletes, right? Because those are individuals that come into the classroom, they have a certain agenda, they're doing certain things, but their culture and their attitude isn't going to affect the rest of the class because they're not the majority. When you start pushing towards the majority of a class being student athletes, I think you really start to see that culture affect the classroom. If half the students are gone every other day because of a training or a therapy session or a trip to another part of the country to play a sport, it doesn't matter whether or not the other students know why they're gone. What they see is an absence. What they see is a lack of engagement. And that lack of engagement affects the whole classroom.
So between 2011 and 2016, there were significant developments on the Adams State campus, both kind of a boom cycle where there was expansion of the north end of campus with athletics facilities that were renovated and really significant development in the Capitol construction. And then toward the end of that time you were at Adams State, there were significant budget cuts and there were, you know, lots of positions that were talk of being eliminated that later were eliminated. And a lot of faculty line items that were froze and a lot of budgets that were frozen. So what was your thought if your in-classroom experience was seeing how that culture of athletics negatively affected the kind of engagement of your students? What was your out-of-classroom experience like at Adams State when you went to all-campus meetings and, you know, you were in department meetings looking at budgets and looking at the way the university was allocating priorities financially and administratively?
I got involved with some of this early on, but I was very interested early on in thinking about how to come together with other faculty and staff members on campus to think about improving wages. Wages across the United States have been, you know, slipping compared with inflation rates across the last 30, 40 years. But at Adams State, it was very clear that, you know, wages just weren't keeping up with the price of goods and services in the community. And so it was becoming more expensive to live, but it was becoming even more expensive to get by because wages were stagnant. Every once in a while you get a COOPA adjustment or a cost of living adjustment, but they would come every 2 or 3 years, and of course inflation was going up every year. And you never really got a raise. A COOPA adjustment's not a raise. It keeps you up with the cost of goods and services. And so while I was at Adams State, at least, I didn't get a raise other than for promotion. You know, I became involved early on in thinking about this. I was surprised because when I asked about faculty sheets, I come from an institution at the University of New Mexico where you go to a search engine, it shows you any faculty or adjunct or lecturer or anyone else, staff member salary. Online because it's a public university and there was an idea that transparency should be a part of how that money is spent. But when I got to Adams State, there was a rumor that somebody said, well, there's a rumor that they might be in the library. You go to the library and no one could seem to find them, or if they found them, they were incomplete because they hadn't been updated by HR. It was suggested that you should be secretive about getting them. You should go to somebody that already has them because you don't want people to know that you're poking around to look for them.
And let me just interject quickly. Ben, why is it that it would be a problem for you to ask for the public salary data of your institution?
Yeah, I mean, I come back to, you know, behind every door, it seemed like there was a secret that somebody didn't want to get out. I very much got the sense that there was something about faculty salary that somebody on campus or a group of people on campus didn't really want anyone to look into. I didn't know what that was at the time. But I was recommended very strongly by a senior mentor before I had tenure not to dig too deep until I had tenure. And I think I was, lucky to have heeded her advice. And so I did so, and I waited until I had tenure, and then I started looking more into the questions of faculty salary data, got a hold of some of it, started looking through it, started running some numbers. And really, you know, just basically what came out right away was there was massive inequities in terms of how people were paid across campus. And there was both inequities across faculty and staff, but there was even larger discrepancies between faculty administration, staff administration. So you would have positions in coming back to the athletics part of our conversation, you'd have positions in athletics that were getting paid well over what our, you know, kind of competing universities within the region were paying their athletics directors or athletics coaches, etc. But then you would have faculty members, the majority of faculty members, who were well below what area the universities are paying their professors and their staff. And so it seemed like there were discrepancies there that needed attention or needed explanation. And so as one started looking into this, it became less and less clear what those explanations or justifications would be. I actually had an in-depth conversation with Tracy Rogers about this, who runs human resources. And, you know, I kind of left that conversation. This was early on looking into this. And I left that conversation with incomplete answers. It just wasn't clear to me why certain individuals, so I'll give you an example from some of the lists. There was instances where you would have an assistant football coach getting paid well over what competing institutions were paying their assistant football coaches, but you would have high-performing faculty members getting paid 25 or 30% below what competing universities were paying their faculty members. And so the argument or the justification that Human Resource Office would give when explaining these differences was that's what the market demands. And so the market for coaches is high and hot, and so we have to pay them more in order for them to come. But that didn't seem to pan out when comparing to other institutions. In fact, Other institutions were demonstrating exactly the opposite, that you could in fact pay less for those positions and still keep the individuals. I didn't quite understand those explanations or justifications, and I kept digging.
Well, it would seem like, just based on what you were told, if those percentages, if those averages are based on what other peer institutions, there were something like 80 or 90 peer institutions across the country, similar to Adams State with respect to its, you know, funding stream and campus size, etc. If those campuses were paying less, then the notion that the market, the national market, was so hot that Adams State had to pay more, almost seems like Adams State just didn't understand what it was paying for. And it was frankly way overpaying when it came to its coaching staff and athletics, and frequently way underpaying when it came to its faculty and many other staff on campus.
Yeah, I think that's, to a certain degree, that's true. I mean, I think there are certain individuals within the coaching staff at Adams State that could get paid much more elsewhere. An example that comes to mind is Coach Martin. I mean, he's won championship after championship after championship. I'm sure he could go to a large university, CU Boulder, University of Kentucky, some other, you know, D1 program, and probably get paid significantly more than what he's currently getting paid at Adams State. But I think he's probably the exception to the norm at Adams State in terms of what other coaches could get paid or what other administrators could get paid outside of Adams State. You know, I actually think that when you look at those national numbers, you do come to wonder, you know, what's happening here? Why are some people or some individuals making more? And the only explanation that really made sense at the end of the day to me was there was a culture of giving raises to certain individuals that were within the right groups. I mean, that seemed to really pan out in terms of trying to explain these discrepancies more than anything else.
So at the end of the day, you had opened up a number of Pandora's boxes around campus, and it seems like that what you discovered when you peered inside them were things that you could not unsee. So how did you go on with your time at Adams State toward those latter years? Once you had asked those questions, you found some answers that were at least somewhat displeasing, and what efforts, if any, did you discover to try and correct those mechanisms? Or, you know, your time on the Faculty Senate, for example, did you find that yielded any of the ground that you might need to sufficiently address issues that we have talked about so far?
You know, I got into Faculty Senate hoping that that would be the type of arena in which one could address these types of issues. And I found out very early on that it wasn't. An individual, you know, senior faculty member who's since retired and who was president of Faculty Senate when I left, told me that good ideas die in Faculty Senate. And that's verbatim to what I was, you know, told when I was bringing some of these issues to him. And that, you know, that surprised me, but at the same time, it seemed to be on par with what my experience had been within Faculty Senate. It did not seem like it was the type of space in which you could advance actual change on campus. I found that committee work occasionally did yield results. One of the committees that I was on that I thought, you know, led to a good result was the faculty salary committee for summer salary or summer compensation. And that was an interesting experience because we were initially charged with something that didn't make a whole lot of sense. But I think as a committee, we worked through coming to a solution that worked for the rest of campus. And the initial charge was, you know, we were basically informed, we were told that summer classes were not sustainable, that they were costing the institution too much money, and that the institution was considering shutting down summer school altogether. That didn't make sense to me because the campus stays open during the summer regardless. The institution has to, you know, basically, you know, institutions are just like in a house. If you leave it empty for 3 or 4 months, it starts to fall apart. And so you have to have people on campus, grounds crews, administrators, people are still there, the energy's still on.
And the real tragedy is that the climate in the San Luis Valley is the most favorable in the summer. I know as a year-round resident, I always pitied the students who would arrive in August or September and leave in May, and they were there during the kind of the colder months of the San Luis Valley. They weren't acclimated to, and they always missed out on, you know, the best time to be in the San Luis Valley.
True. Well, in this case, you know, the idea I think was to kind of scare us into agreeing to lower salaries in the summer, so the summer classes would be offered and we could continue to make summer money in the summer. It just didn't make a lot of sense to me. And so we invited in the senior finance officer at the time, and he came out and he said, you know, we need summer school. Summer school is what helps us make up the difference at the end of the year. And that's when it became more clear what we were being asked to do. We were being asked to basically come up with a solution that gave even more of the compensation that, you know, professors get for teaching a summer class back to the institution. So lowering salaries for professors as a means of helping the bottom line, which in a very difficult fiscal time, I think, is the type of conversation you have to have. That said, I didn't think that we actually needed to do that, because once I started looking at the salary sheets for summer compensation with other professors, it became very evident there was massive inequalities in terms of how different professors across different departments were paid or compensated for summer salary. And so you'd have individuals in the business department, for example, making upwards of $8,000-$9,000 per class for a 3-credit class. And then you would have other individuals in, say, social sciences making somewhere around $2,500 or $3,600, depending on where they were at in their career. Because at that time, summer salary is tied to your base salary. And so if you had a higher base salary, you would make much more in the summer. And so,
and it's not like the students pay those wide-ranging amounts when it came to the tuition that they would pay for summer classes. So the input into the system was relatively similar, and yet the output in terms of what faculty were compensated was widely
disparate.
That's
exactly right. And so what we came up with was just a simple formula in which we capped salaries. We just created a range in which assistant professors got paid a certain amount. I think it was $4,000, and then associates $4,500, and then a full professor paid $5,000 per 3-credit class in the summer. And so it worked out for everybody. For like 80% of the campus, it meant a raise for summer compensation. And for about 20%, it meant a slight reduction in their pay, or a pretty significant reduction in some cases. But what it allowed for was a much more equitable compensation of income across campus. And it didn't cost the university any more to do it. And so you had much more buy-in from faculty in terms of giving classes during the summer than we previously did. And I think, you know, that makes campus all the more sustainable. It also helps towards retention, or in theory it should, because you have more individuals staying in the summer to take credits at Adams as opposed to somewhere else back home, which might then lead them into a door that they never come back out of, right, in another institution. And so, you know, I think that was a successful case, but it started down a similar path in terms of the other paths that I kind of, you know, sought out and trying to search for ways to address faculty compensation and staff compensation. It started out with some secrets. And once those secrets were uncovered, it became more clear what the actual issue was. But it was clear that initially nobody wanted to reveal the actual situation to us. In fact, just getting the Excel sheets was much, much more difficult than it should have been. I was given the Excel sheets for faculty compensation this summer, but I was told not to share them with the committee. But it's hard to do committee work transparently if you don't share the information you're using to base your decisions with the rest of the committee, right?
Now, why were you told not to share them? Were you given a reason?
Well, I mean, the basic idea that the reason that I was given is that it could, you know, people could misinterpret them across campus. People couldn't be trusted with the numbers, in other words.
In other words, this is a group of adults that really can't be trusted with looking at this data on their own and drawing their own conclusions. They might come to the wrong conclusion.
Despite their PhDs, yeah.
Well, so during your last year or two there, you indicated you had some real concerns about the hire of Beverly McClure as president. And I know we started our podcast series with you interviewing me while I was banned from the campus. And of course, there's a lot of information out there for people that are interested in learning more about that. But we haven't really heard your side of the story in terms of what it was like for you seeing one of your colleagues kind of cast out and exiled from the ASU community while we continued to be friends and hang out together. And there was a certain point at which you tried to kind of initiate and open a dialogue to resolve this matter without it resulting in a lawsuit, without it resulting and some of the acrimony that ensued. Can you tell some version of that story for our audience in terms of what that was like for you?
Yeah, I will. I mean, it was a difficult moment in the sense that there was a new energy that summer. There was a sense that a new president could come in with business experience and turn Adams down a path towards growth and towards retention and towards, you know, further recruitment. And, you know, very early on, there was some doubts about whether or not that was actually going to work. Once you were banned from campus, I think, you know, whole conversation started around the constitutionality of that issue that in many ways just distracted from the ability of anyone to move forward with the type of work that needed to be done on the actual campus. The reason that I took up that issue within Faculty Senate, the idea of free speech and the campus being part of a public space in which people shouldn't be banned from, it didn't seem like the type of thing that we should be spending that much time with. It was kind of a non-factor. He was an individual that clearly was not a threat to campus. And for whatever reason, he was being presented as if he were a terrorist or as if he was the type of person that was going to cause harm to somebody else, despite no previous record of ever causing anyone any harm. And so it just didn't seem like the type of, it seemed like the type of thing that we should be able to logically go in the faculty senate and say, this is a non-issue, let's just move forward and move on to the work that is most important to this campus. But that's not what happened. You know, the administration, for one reason or another, chose to really double down on the issue and spend a great deal of the next 2 years dealing with it. And so it was a difficult time to find myself in the position of having taken a position that was not popular across campus. I think in retrospect, I'm happy that I did, because I think at the end of the day, it's clear that that was the type of issue we shouldn't have been worrying about and we should have moved on to other issues. But I you know, at the time, it was difficult. There was a lot of colleagues that I trusted, that I got along with well, who were friends of mine, who chose to disassociate with me as a result of my association with you.
And during that time, you know, I was not in direct communication with Beverly McClure, but at least on one occasion, you did meet with her to try and figure out how she and I could meet or how we could facilitate a matter of resolving whatever the concerns were regarding the campus ban. And that was before the lawsuit or any of that nature. Things could have gone very differently. What happened there from your perspective?
I mean, really, it's quite simple. And, you know, looking back on it, it still didn't quite make sense why this would have happened this way, but this is how it happened. There was a special faculty senate meeting coming up. I believe it was scheduled for a Tuesday. I don't have the exact date in front of me, but, you know, across campus have been talking about the constitutionality of this issue, about banning people, about whether that was a road that Adams State should be going down, whether or not it was the type of thing we should focus on. It was contentious, which was clear. It was also clear that it wasn't one of our main priorities in terms of, you know, kind of keeping the institution alive and really moving the institution forward. And so there was, you know, talk about across campus about how the issue could be diffused. I'm not sure why or how, but the president reached out to me before that special faculty meeting on a Tuesday and asked me and another colleague, Jeff Ellison, to meet with the head of finance at that time.
Kurt Carey,
but I can't remember his exact position. I think that she changed that name slightly after she got there.
Yeah. He was the vice president of operations, okay, so, or something of that nature.
So she had asked that she'd reached out through him to have us, Jeff Ellison and I, meet with her about the possibility of finding some type of middle ground with you. And it was, you know, known across campus that Jeff and I knew you and that you were a friend of ours. And so I suppose that's the reason that she had him reach out to us. We talked at length with Mr. Carey the week before that faculty senate meeting. And then I was even asked, I was on a Sunday, asked to join a private party of administrators with the president prior to that Sunday. I had no idea that, you know, these meetings were taking place, but I was asked to be a part of it. And I thought it was an important enough issue. And so on a Sunday, I took the, you know, 2 or 3 hours that morning out of my day to go meet with the president and several other administrators about the situation and where it might lead. That leading up to that faculty senate meeting seemed to me like a positive sign. It seemed like a sign of perhaps transparency and interest in actually, you know, finding some middle ground and finding a way out of the situation that didn't involve legal parties. But then come Tuesday in that meeting, it became very clear that, you know, it was all just part of painting a picture that wasn't true. And I don't know how many of the listeners were actually there or how many people or what took place, but the president walked into that meeting and it was, you know, basically a speech that she had prepared for faculty, senate, and staff. And she, very early on in the speech, accused Mr. Ellison and I of being sexist male professors and trying to influence the way she thought. I, of course, was flabbergasted because she had been the one to invite us into those conversations in the first place. And so it was a very difficult moment. It was a difficult meeting to sit through. It was difficult to, you know, a number of colleagues within that room gasped when she said what she said. And of course, those gasps were directly at Mr. Ellison and I. And so it was just a very difficult moment. At that moment, I really wondered whether or not my future was in jeopardy. I mean, it was the president of the university standing in front of us, accusing us of sexism, essentially.
So at that point, you had tenure, but you were also really looking more seriously, having already uncovered some of those unpleasant secrets, and now trying to make a good faith effort to move on from what you thought would be a minor matter with regard to the campus operations. When did you start going from casually looking at other places to work to more seriously deciding, I need to get out of here?
I mean, after that meeting, it was very clear to me that it was going to be better for me professionally to move on. It was clear to me that I enjoyed my classroom, I enjoyed my students. I had some pretty good projects going on. I had about $100,000 in grant money I brought to Adams State that I left on the table when in leaving at the end of 2016. Some of that work is still being, you know, carried out across the valley. And so it's nice to see that that had a lasting impact. It was also difficult at the time, however, to break with that work because we were still in the middle of it. And so it was bittersweet, but it was clear to me that professionally, it didn't look like I was going to be able to continue to advance at Adams State as a professor, and I wasn't even sure if professionally I would be retained because it was that contentious, and so I chose to very seriously look at some other offers that I had received that fall, and I ended up taking one, which took my family to Central America, to Nicaragua.
And so now you're back in the United States. So where you're currently teaching, tell us about the work that you're doing now. And then, you know, in your conversation with colleagues at your current institution, what is your sense of their experience? How unique was your observations of Adams State in perspective to what they're telling you about what they had experienced perhaps at other similar institutions?
I'm currently working at Fort Lewis College in Durango, Colorado. So I came back to the States, but didn't move too far away from the Valley. And I'm happy because we have a lot of family and friends in the area, lots of friends still in the San Luis Valley. So we're very connected to that area as well. But this is also very close to where I grew up. So it's, you know, it's kind of a homecoming of sorts. And it's really nice to be back in a space that feels so familiar. The institution itself is, you know, in many ways very similar to Adams State, also different. It's a different local economy. It's a larger town. And so, you know, it's a little bit different space in that sense. The campus itself is a bit different. The student population is similar, larger here, but not much larger. Hovers around 3,500. You know, lots of first-time students, lots of first-generation students, lots of minorities. We're a minority-serving institution for the first time in history. So there's, I think it's about 53% of our students are now minorities. So it's in that sense, it's a similar feel as well. Adams State was a Hispanic-serving institution and had a high percentage of minorities as well. And so the largest percentage of our students are Native Americans, around 36-37%. I think Hispanics come in around 11%. And then there's a number of other individuals that make up the other 50, the difference to make up 53. Yeah.
And so I know you'd indicated as we were talking about this interview that you've had colleagues tell you sort of similar stories or observations to yours,
yeah,
that your experience at Adams State was not that unique. Can you tell us a little bit about what you've heard and kind of the conclusions that's led you
so
to?
I do know that I've met a number of colleagues that have ended up here at Fort Lewis College that have come from other small institutions and rural spaces across the country, including South Dakota and North Dakota and Nebraska and a few other spaces. And they've told me very similar stories. That one, they're very happy to be here because Fort Lewis seems to be a very stable institution and also seems to just have a little bit different feel in terms of the future and the potential of the university or the college in this case. But these folks I'm thinking of are other, you know, kind of younger faculty members in the 20s or 30s who fell into a first job in a rural space and just realized very quickly that the university or the college was in a very dire financial situation and that their future wasn't clear at that institution. It wasn't clear whether or not the institution was going to remain open over the remainder of their career. And so for that reason, they started looking for other positions and other jobs. And so I found that interesting because, you know, I think it overlaps with this growing trend that we were talking about the other day in which funding for public education across the United States is dropping. And it makes rural institutions specifically, like Adams State, very vulnerable. And I think that vulnerability can lead to contentious politics, even amongst people that get along quite well or previously gotten along quite well. And I think, you know, that was my experience at Adams State. And I was very surprised by that. I was surprised by the ways in which financial hardship could lead to divisions across campus. And so I think it's a learning moment looking back on it. But I think, you know, any long-term solution to this situation is going to involve people getting involved with national politics and thinking about ways to improve funding for public education. And I think that naturally involves getting the youth engaged in politics and thinking about the ways in which either directly they can get involved in politics or finding ways to pressure their representatives to care about public education and the future of it. And really, you know, I think our democracy depends on it. You know, I think when we look at the types of contentious politics in this nation currently today, a lot of it has to do with this move to privatize education, which really is a cornerstone of democracy. And when you privatize education, I think you move your nation closer and closer to corporate states or a corporate state type feel that is just not in line with democratic politics.
So I guess I'll kind of use this as our final kind of contrasting point to take away from. You spent about a year teaching in Nicaragua, and you left the country at a time when the turmoil in the region was escalating, and you had some observations about perhaps cautionary tales from studying Latin American politics that we as Americans should probably at least take notice of, you know, given the experiences you've had directly. What has that led you, your time away from the United States teaching and then coming back? How has that shaped or influenced the way you look at United States education specifically?
So I think I'll tackle this on two different levels, one on a general level and then on a more specific level. On the general level, I think, you know, what I've learned most about society in general in living outside the country, both in Nicaragua and in other moments in Argentina and Mexico, is that massive inequality, and I'm thinking of income inequality and wealth inequality, just massive disparities in terms of who has resource and who doesn't. Anytime you have massive inequality, it's very, very difficult for democratic politics to work and shared governance in general to function. And so at the local level, you know, at the, you know, I had experienced that at Adams State. There was massive inequalities in terms of who had access to resource distribution, who had access to, you know, kind of decision-making spaces on Adams State campus. But I think that parallels what I've seen at the more general level in spaces like Nicaragua, where you have really, really large inequalities. And I mean, these are the types of inequalities that are just baffling. But the starting wage, for example, for a domestic worker, a live-in domestic worker, somebody who, you know, works 15 days on and then has 2 or 3 days off and then comes back for another 15 days on. In Nicaragua, that starting wage is $170 a month. And that just seems so out of line with any general notion of fair wages, even in a country in which goods and services are cheaper in the United States. And it really is, because the cost of living in Nicaragua is much, much higher than that. And so the cost of living for somebody runs around $400 a month. And it's just astounding to me that such a large percentage of people in Nicaragua and around the world, because about 80% of the world lives in a similar situation, it's astounding to me that so many people live in a situation which their wages don't even come close to their monthly expenses. And so as a result, of course, lots of people have to pool their wages together and live together in small spaces to get by. The fear that I have in coming back to the United States is the depth of the inequality that I currently see in the country. I mean, the inequality in the United States is masked. I think it's masked in at least in part because there's general easy access to credit and people are able to live a bit beyond their means every year. But that eventually that's got to give. Eventually that can't go on forever. And as the middle class shrinks in the United States and inequality grows, the consumer base, which is about 70% of the U.S. economy, is going to disappear. You know, right now we have a situation in which even education is on credit. You know, the majority of our students are getting an education over 4 or 5 years on massive loans. And that has surpassed private credit loans, or, you know, debt at this point in our nation. So I think we're at a point where somewhere in the near future, something is going to have to give. There's going to be a breaking point.
And especially when the loans that they're taking out for that education are almost impossible for them to pay back with the job market that's available to them after they complete their degree.
Yeah, and so, I mean, you start to get that sense. I mean, that sounds like indentured servitude. That sounds like a company store. It sounds like the type and situation in which you're trapped into a cycle of debt that you can never get out of. And that's what is true of almost all people who live in the developing world today, right? A huge percentage, 90% of the people that live in developing countries are trapped into cycles of debt that they can't escape. In fact, the main way through which people escape those types of cycles of debt are by migrating to countries like the United States or Spain or France, etc. And so migration has become, in our globalized world, the main means through which people are able to access social mobility. In the United States, that's not been the case in the past. It's been education. It's been improving your human capital. It's been working hard to get ahead. But I think we're reaching a point in which young people are going to start to realize that education is no longer the means of sociability that used to be. And there's going to be a reckoning moment. And it's going to go one of two ways. Either there's going to be a moment of youth engagement in which we push towards actual social change and a redistribution of resources in a way in which public education and social mobility returns through lowering income inequality and wealth inequality. Or we're going to move closer to a situation that's more like, you know, South Africa or other highly developed countries in some senses with high degrees of poverty and massive inequality.
All right. Well, final takeaway point, now that you've had some distance between yourself and your time at Adams State, are there any recommendations or closing thoughts for people still on campus that know you and perhaps those that don't, that are newer? What advice would you give or what recommendations would you have to make the campus itself a more well-functioning experience, even if we can acknowledge that on a national level, there are still many barriers that probably need some systemic adjustment?
Gosh, you know, I mean, I think that's a difficult question. I've been away for about 2 years. I don't think I have a sense of where Adams is at currently. I know that they have a new president. I know that there's some new administrators. I know there's lots of new faces in terms of faculty. I don't think I could make any recommendations based on my experience that would be useful, aside from, you know, just really encouraging transparency and shared governance. And I think if enough people are involved in decision-making across campus or feel that their voice has a space in which it can be heard, I think, you know, people can move forward together. But I think as soon as there's an effort to shut down voices, whether it's critical or not across campus, you start to see, you know, very contentious politics develop and you start to see divisions across campus. So, I mean, I guess the only advice I could have, which I think is really advice for any good functioning campus, is to really buy into the power and the importance of shared governance.
Great. Well, thanks for joining us. And it's been a pleasure talking to you about your current endeavors and things of that nature. If people want to follow you or learn more about your work, how can they do that?
I mean, I have a personal website, which is benjaminjameswaddell.com. Waddell is spelled W-A-D-D-E-L-L. I've also been writing frequently in the last few months about the situation in Nicaragua, so people might have interest in following that. They could look up some of the stuff I wrote in the Huffington Post, or on my website I have most of my short work on there as well. So that's probably a good space to find it.
Great. Well, thanks for joining us, Ben.
Thank you.
I appreciate it.
Have a good day.